गले में गला दबा।
गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट अ न्यू चैप्टर एंड द चैप्टर इज चैप्टर नंबर 4 एब्जॉर्प्शन बाय रूट। बेसिकली वी आर स्टार्टिंग अ न्यू यूनिट दैट इज प्लांट फिजियोलॉजी इन विच वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट द फंक्शंस ऑफ प्लांट एंड वी विल डिस्कस हाउ ईच एंड इंडिविजुअल पार्ट लाइक सेल टिश्यू हाउ दे आर वर्किंग टूगेदर एंड डूइंग सम स्पेसिफिक टास्क इन द प्लांट्स। I am not taking the chapter genetics right now because last time it was covered by the board examination. So maybe this time also the chapter can get deducted. If not, we can do laterwards. So when we talk about a plant physiology, so we are talking about the life functions of the plant, and here the important part of this life function is the root. So root, basically we can call root as a life support system of the plant. Why is it called life support system? Because as you know that root is having a specific tissue that is known as xylem, and xylem, it is required for the conduction of water and mineral. Conduction of water and mineral. And this chapter deals with about the absorption which is done by the root. So first thing, that why there is a requirement of water and mineral. So we will discuss here. Water and minerals, it is required for the following things. Now, for the first process is photosynthesis, and as you know the photosynthesis, the process by which plant is making their food. Second, it is transpiration. Third, it is transportation. The last one is mechanical stiffness. Basically, these are the four important points which you have to remember, that why the plant requires water and minerals. Talking about photosynthesis, as you know that the plant is manufacturing the food in the leaf by the process of photosynthesis, and the equation you already know is the formation of starch and the liberation of oxygen. So this is the process by which the autotrophs, that means the plant that is manufacturing their food, and this food is translocated to different body part by the tissue, that is the phloem. Second is transpiration. Transpiration is basically the loss of water from the aerial part of the plant. Basically the loss of water from aerial part of the plant is like leaves in the form of vapor. So if the too much amount of water is there in the body of plant also try to remove that water. And how it is removed? By the process of this transpiration. Transpiration is a chapter is given in our syllabus that we will discuss later. Now third is the transportation. Transportation, that means the movement of the particles from one point to another. Now when we talk about the particles, so it will have the water molecule as well as minerals. That means the movement of water from one region to another, as well as the movement of food from one region to another. And when we talk about the minerals, minerals are generally present in two forms in plants, and these forms are either they are present in the form of salt or either they are present in the form of ions. When we are talking about the salts, they can be present in the form of nitrate, sulfate, and whenever we are talking about the ions, so it can be sodium ion, calcium ion, magnesium ion. So they can be in the form of salts or in the form of ions. And at the last, mechanical stiffness is required, because for this conduction of water and minerals, there should be turgidity. So turgidity, it is an important process by which different cell in the plant body, it is able to translocate these water and mineral to different body parts. So these are the four parts which you can easily remember, and you can make a flow chart like this, a flow diagram like this, so that you can understand it easily. Now our next topic is the characteristics of root for absorbing water, that how the roots they are adapted for absorbing the water and minerals. So here I have drawn the structure of a root, and now we will label this. So first of all, this part is known as epidermal cell. Now as you know, since it is the cell of a plant, so a plant cell will have the outer cell wall and the inner cell membrane, or we can call it as plasma membrane. Now here in this, you will find vacuoles. As you know that vacuoles, they are bigger and larger in plant cells, and you will get a nucleus in this region. Now this is basically fully grown root here. Fully grown root here, and from here we can also make an extension, and it is basically the structure which is about to modify, and later on this will change into a fully grown root here. So here you can write it as new root here. So basically this is the structure of a root here. And the first characteristic for absorbing water is the surface area of the root. For example, in the plant like balsam, in a balsam plant, the root is modified and it is having an adventitious root system in which so many root hairs are present. So many root hairs are present, and remember one thing, greater is the surface area of the root, maximum will be the absorption of water. So greater surface area, maximum will be absorption of water and minerals. So that's why we can say that a fibrous root system can absorb more water rather than a dead root system in plant. So this is the first characteristic of root for absorbing water. Now second one is the root here, it contains the cell sap higher than the concentration of cell. Second one is root here. Now in this root here, the concentration, the content of the cell sap is in higher concentration than of water. Concentration of cell sap. Now when we talk about the cell sap is basically the liquid material which is present in the vacuole region. And when we talk about the root hair, first of all, what is root hair? So you must know that root hair is basically the extension of the epidermal cell of a root. It is the extension of epidermal cell. The structure is basically the extension of the epidermal cell. That means the cell which is present on the outer surface, it is basically extended outwards and taking the shape of a root hair. Now here, as I said earlier, that it is having a larger vacuole, and a larger vacuole means the concentration of cell sap, means the liquid content here will be greater. So cell sap, it contains water and minerals along with salts. So when we talk about cells, are water and minerals are present, and the concentration of this cells is higher than the water present alongside. So this is basically the second characteristics of root for absorption of water. And now third one, when we talk about the third one, since it is a plant cell, it is having the cell wall. Now the cell wall should be thin. So third characteristic is that root hairs have thin wall. As you can see here that when we talk about the root hair, so root hair is having outer cell wall and cell membrane. Now cell wall, as you know that cell wall is fully permeable. It permits entry of all the molecules, just like molecules of water, gaseous molecules, even the nutrients, ions can go inside. However, cell membrane is basically selectively permeable in nature. It allows only the few molecules to enter into this cytoplasmic region, and this is maintained by these two layers. That means the two layers, cell wall and cell membrane, are responsible for the movement of this water into this root structure. Cell wall, it will allow all the things to enter inside the root, while cell membrane, it allows the only few specific molecules to enter inside the root hairs. So this you can note down in your notebook. Now the next topic is absorption and conduction of water and minerals. And for this, there are various phenomena that we will discuss in this chapter one by one. There are basically the prominent five phenomena is given in the chapter, and we will have a look on this one by one. So the first process is imbibition. The second process is diffusion. The third process or phenomena is osmosis. The fourth phenomena is active transport. The fifth and the last phenomena is turgidity and flaccidity that we can call as plasmolysis. So these are basically the five phenomena by which absorption of water and minerals is taking place in plant. First we are talking about the imbibition. Imbibition is basically a surface phenomena. Imbibition is basically a surface phenomena or the process of surface attraction in which the water molecules, it adhere on the surface of the roots as well as on the shoot system of the plant, and the plant, it is imbibing that water inside. So it is basically a surface phenomena, and those things which are made up of cellulose. Cellulose, it is basically hydrophilic in nature. Hydrophilic means water loving. So cellulose, it is hydrophilic in nature. Since it is hydrophilic, it allows all the water to get easily absorbed, easily soaked inside them. So those things which is made up of cellulose, they are hydrophilic and they are taking the water inside by the process which is imbibition. For example, in the winter season, the doors get swelled up because the water get imbibed by the surface of the door. Apart from this, the swelling up of the seed, the dry seeds get swelled up. Even in the process of the germination, the seed coat ruptures, and from here the new phloem and the new radical start germinating. So the first process is the imbibition. Second process which we are talking is about the diffusion. Diffusion you have done earlier in the previous classes, and I hope that you must know this phenomena. And the second one is diffusion. Diffusion is basically the movement of a particle or the movement of molecule from a region of higher concentration to lower concentration. Movement of molecule from higher concentration to lower concentration. So that means in the soil, if the soil is having higher amount of water, the water will move from soil into the root, because the root is having less concentration of the water. So water is going from soil to the root by the process of diffusion also. So the second one is diffusion. Apart from this diffusion, another example we can take diffusion, dissolving of sugar or potassium permanganate in water. So whenever we will put sugar cube or potassium permanganate in the water, the color of the water change. That means it is getting diffused in the water. Another example we can take, that whenever we are spreading perfume. So whenever we used to put perfume, if you just spray that perfume in a shorter area, it will get widespread in the whole room. Second example can be this. Sometimes whenever the mother is cooking food, at that time if the food is delicious, you can easily smell that what is cooking because of the process of diffusion. Because these particles, they get diffused in the atmosphere. Remember one thing, in the process of the diffusion, the temperature is very much required. Greater is the temperature, greater is the amount of diffusion. Now the third process is the osmosis. Osmosis is also, you have done in the previous class. Third one, osmosis. Osmosis is the process, is the generally same. That means movement of, remember one thing, in the diffusion, all the particles, all the molecules are traveling and going from one place to another, from one concentration to another. Here only the movement of water molecule takes place. The movement of water molecule from higher concentration, from higher concentration to lower concentration. But the important thing to remember here is that it is having a semi-permeable membrane. So the movement of water molecule from higher concentration to lower concentration through a semi-permeable membrane. This you have to remember this. But what is of osmosis? Here the molecules of water only can go from higher to lower concentration in the presence of a semi-permeable membrane. The students, they often get confused between diffusion and osmosis, but the actual difference between these are, it is having only the water molecule and it is having a semi-permeable membrane. Now osmosis is further divided into two parts, and this is endosmosis and exosmosis. Endosmosis means the water molecules, it is moving inside the cell, while exosmosis, the water molecules, it is going outside the cell into the surrounding. So this is osmosis and further divided into endosmosis and exosmosis. So one experiment is given in your book, and it is figure 4.4. It is related to the osmosis. Now here, if you see the diagram which is given in the book, here you will find a cellophane paper is given and a cell funnel is given. In one we have taken sugar solution, in the other we have taken only water as a control, and in the beaker, in this beaker we are having water. Now what is the role of this cellophane paper in this? This cellophane paper, it acts as a semi-permeable membrane. So what will be the end result of this? Here if you can see, this is the initial level of the water, that means the initial level of the sugar solution inside this thistle funnel, and here the initial level of water. Why we have taken water and not the sugar solution in that? Because the B1, it is for the control. to see the changes whether it is happening or not. What is the difference we will get here? Let's see. So whenever, after some time, whenever you will submerge this thistle funnel into the water, after some time, the water, it will start moving from this beaker and it will cross this semipermeable membrane, that means this cellophane paper, and after 1 to 2 hours, there will be initial rise in the level of the water and the level of water goes to here. That means it reaches to the final level. That means this is basically the change which is done when the water is moving from higher concentration to lower concentration through this semi-permeable membrane. But in case of B, since we have taken water here and here also, there will be no change in the concentration in both the sections. So we can easily find that the water is moving from higher to a lower concentration. And why you can say this, that it is moving from here to here only? Because when we will taste this water will not be sweet as which is present in the sugar solution. If it would go from here to here, that means from sugar solution to the water, then this water must be sweet in nature. But whenever you taste this, it will not be that much sweet or not be sweet at all. So this means that diffuse osmosis is always taking place from higher concentration to lower concentration, and here the important thing to remember that a semi-permeable membrane is required. So this is the figure 4.4. You can read this in your book. It is given clearly. So in today's video, we are taking in osmosis. However, some portion of the osmosis is still left, which we are going to discuss in next video. Apart from this, the other topics which is remaining, we will cover in that section. If you find anything difficult, you can ask me or you can directly call on my phone number. Thank you and have a great day.